brain isn't here right now. But if you'd like to make an appointment.
Welcome back, pop stars. Fino here. Tell me something. What keeps a gimmick from reaching glory? Practicality, expense, meta-relevance, coming out the same year as Lost Belt 6? All good answers, but I think you'll find no one straddles this line harder than one Miss Crane. She's a limited 5-star caster introduced in Grail Concert, and her kit is absolutely overflowing with gimmicks. But is she the perfect storm where it all comes together? Let's find out. We'll be doing things in a bit of a different order because MC Crane's kit centers overwhelmingly around her noble phantasm. Innocence, the Crane's tearful farewell poem, is a non-damaging arts NP that gives a number of buffs to the leftmost servant on your frontline. An attack buff tied to NP level, a flat NP damage, and charge tied to overcharge. Unusual in and of itself, but it has a ton of caveats. Firstly, the recipient can't be Miss Crane herself. I guess unless you're running two for whatever reason. But the one that casts Farewell Poem can't get its benefits. So if Miss Crane is in slot 1, the servant in slot 2 will get the buffs. Secondly, using this NP at all requires you to have 20 stars available. It doesn't eat them, but needing them in the first place is pretty strange. Now Crane does have a way to generate stars, but like everything with her, it's a bit complicated. You may want to cut out the middleman by running a Stardom Craft Essence instead. The best part is that these are commonly distributed as free event CEs, and in fact, we just got no strings from Akihabara Explosion. A limit broken copy of a 5-star Stardom CE will give 20, exactly the number you need for Farewell Poem's activation requirement. More optimized options include Hidehunter for its NP gain effect, and Golden Catches of the Carp for its starting charge. Depending on your setup, the latter can even enable some Chain Crane with a splash of charge from your other support. You can also opt for a Mystic Code like Anniversary Blonde if you're running a Buster lineup. Farewell Poem's third twist is that it ejects Miss Crane off the battlefield, but instead of being a Chen Gong-style trip to Belize, it places her at the very end of your roster. Think of it like she's being placed on the right side and shoving the rest of your backline forward, with your first reserve taking your slot on the field. In this regard, she acts as a pseudo-plug suit, letting you get her useful buffs and then replacing yourself with a fresh unit, typically another support. Now, unlike the combat uniform, you don't keep your deck on swap. Instead, it fully resets as if you're on a fresh cycle. Miss Crane leaves the field as soon as her NP finishes, but her replacement doesn't enter until the end of your turn. So in that regard, it operates as if one of your servants got KO'd. And because Crane departs immediately, you need to be careful not to put any of her cards after her NP. They'll just fizzle. Now, getting her online NP can be a bit of a hassle, but let's start with the easier of the two requirements. Charge. On this front, Crane has Overnight Howdy. It's a 100% battery for herself, but has two side effects. Firstly, it nails her for 2k health. It won't kill her, so no worries on that front. The other effect is that it taunts your other frontliners for 3 turns. The 100% battery in and of itself makes this your top priority for leveling. The taunt, however, is more of a mixed bag. Taunting your other support is useful in terms of getting your team to cycle even faster, but one of the targets is going to be your main attacker, and they're going to have a 50-50 chance of getting hit every attack for 3 turns. This can accumulate into a very substantial amount of damage taken, so you'll want to keep an eye out for servants with protection. Thankfully, Miss Crane herself can account for one of these turns with Lady's Affection for Garments. It grants party invuln, star absorption, and also stardom based on how many costume-owning allies are on the field. None of these effects count or work on Miss Crane herself, so the stardom in particular is going to cap out at 20 in exchange for greatly restricting your team building. The upside is that at 5 turns, it'll be up fairly often. Another upside is that you don't actually need the outfit equipped or even unlocked for it to work. If they have one at all, it counts. 20 stars is exactly enough to use Farewell Poem, but relying exclusively on Lady's Affection for Garments is going to create some problems. There are a lot of costume-owning servants. That said, their synergy with each other can be a bit questionable at times. For supportive characters, you have Koyanskaya of Light, Merlin, Caster Gilgamesh, Caster Helena, Mash, Paracelsus, Asclepius, Jean, and Summer BB. The lack of Castoria and either Scotty on this list means that when you try and pair Miss Crane with Arts and Quick Attackers, you'll need to have an additional source of stars, unless of course you're using Ruler Scotty, who has a star dump. We talked about a few options earlier, but I want to add that flat star command codes can give you an additional, if delayed, way of supplementing your income. Holy Knight's Aurora gives 4 on hit, so if your team comps are on the jankier side, you may have need of them. Another way of getting around needing 2 costumes is to run a servant with a star dump. Some attackers have this capability, and you should check during team building. But notably, the ostensive support, Tomovich, can meet this requirement by herself, which makes her especially synergistic with Miss Crane. Then you could just run whatever buster attacker you want. You know what's funny, though? A lot of Vich-compatible servants also have costumes. Saber and Salter, Mordred, Ibuki Doji, Moriarty, Ereshkigal, Ilya, Kentoki, Morgan, Summer BB, technically Space Ishtar. Some of these even have their own stardumps. Suffice to say, there's a lot of future synergy between Miss Crane and the Buster playstyle. And here's an underrated tidbit. Koyanskaya herself can function as an attacker. She's not strictly compatible with her own system on account of her battery having a long cooldown, but Miss Crane can replace herself with a third charger, solving the issue. For instance, you can run a frontline of Vich Crane Vich, which you can then supplement with someone like Waver in your first backline slot. Or how about Oberon? Hold that thought. We'll get back to him in a little bit. Rounding out Ms. Crane's kit is Thousand Year Gratitude, which is a 3-turn buff suite including star absorption, crit damage, and instant kill immunity. All of this at a 5-turn cooldown. The only drawback is that Crane pings herself for 1k every time she does it. Not a big deal. Crane has a lot of her stats loaded into health. In fact, her attack suffers tremendously, putting her in the 4-star range. And on top of this, she's a caster, and casters have the most onerous class penalty in the game, with a base damage multiplier of 0.9. Suffice to say, MC does jack shit in terms of damage, so you're better off avoiding her face cards unless it's to complete an arts or mighty chain. She does have a triple arts deck, so at least the former is easy enough. I'll note the star absorption magnitude on this skill caps out at 500%, which is a digit off being useful for berserkers. For everyone else, though, they can take advantage of this to corral all the stars flying around to meet Ms. Crane's own requirements. As you could tell, Ms. Crane has one complicated kit, though using it ultimately boils down to just popping all her cooldowns at once and then going to get milk at the store. This lends itself to a very bursty playstyle, but she has potential applications in fights where you need to play the long game. By contrast, Chengong uses up your team as rocket fuel. But for battles that force you to wait for defensive mechanics or trash waves to disperse, he'll rapidly deplete your fighting strength. Ms. Crane lets you make an adjustment to your frontline while keeping your reserves stocked and allowing more Mystic Coat flexibility. And if you can find a fight where you need upfront burst followed by a stall phase, she can enable a smooth transition between the two. That said, Farewell Poem putting her in your final slot does have consequences. Because you pop everything immediately, Crane is effectively depleted. If the fight never circles around back to her, that's great, but if she ever re-enters the fight and you're not doing the K-scope strat, you're in deep shit. This creates the most problems when you're relying on an anchor servant. Heracles, Canis, and Ashwataman want their full card set available, and Heracles in particular doesn't want anyone popping his guts and then ping-ponging back after hitting Miss Crane. Here's a fun tidbit. Her Bond CE gives NP gain for costume-owning servants and a lesser amount for herself. But there is a certain irony in a CE that requires her to be on the field when her kit is designed for her to fuck off at the first opportunity. Now, I mentioned a K-scope strat earlier. Because she has a 100% battery, Miss Crane can hypothetically NP twice. You'll need one of the two Pluxus to make this work since she yeets herself off screen. But this enables some nutty combos. Let's say you're running an attacker in your leftmost slot, Crane in the center and Vich on the right. Crane dumps her skills except for her battery, and everyone else pops what they need to get your attacker's NP going. Then you layer Farewell Poem into your offensive NP to get your buffs up front. Miss Crane fucks off and then brings in your first backliner, another Vich. You expend any necessary Vich skills and then plug suit Miss Crane back into your team, replacing one of your depleted Foxes. Because Koyanskaya has a star dump, you meet the condition for Farewell Poem a second time. You can use Crane's battery to get full charge and repeat your combo from turn 1, except this time your backline shifted to make Oberon the target. Oberon gives a crazy amount of charge and a tremendous burst buff. And because you've stacked so many steroids, 2 rounds of Vich buffs, Miss Crane skills, 2 rounds of Crane NPs, Oberon's buffs, and whatever your attacker is packing, you can reach absolutely ludicrous amounts of damage. There are some caveats though. Firstly, this is an outrageously expensive team in terms of deployment cost, requiring you to own at least 3 separate SSRs, 4 assuming your attacker is also one. In all likelihood, this will require running Mash as your final servant if you want to do anything with your Craft Essence loadout. Secondly, adding 2 Miss Crane NPs makes your run really goddamn slow, so unless you absolutely need the damage, you'll end up wasting time over a generic Vich 3 turn. Even adding a single Miss Crane NP might be overkill for typical nodes, so just be aware of your damage needs. But there is a circumstance that calls for a tremendous amount of damage, the fabled 90++ node. These have enemy health values that can approach the 1 million mark, so you never know. And let's not forget about boss fights where you just need to unload damage on consecutive turns. This strat obviously has merit there. One of Miss Crane's passives increases your team's buff success rate by 10% while she's on the field. That's neat, especially for Ilya and Space Ishtar setups, but it won't get either of their effects to 100% by itself. Miss Crane is a very interesting servant, and I think it's safe to say that she successfully jumps the gap from being a pure gimmick into legitimate usefulness. However, she requires you to navigate a team-building minefield, and in general she's a very expensive servant both in deployment and in the damage she does to your wallet. Because her attack buff is tied to her NP level, you're encouraged to go the distance and min-maxers are gonna feel the pinch. She's not a strictly necessary servant in terms of account fundamentals, but I'll say she's undeniably good. I wouldn't blame you for wanting a copy, though given the Gacha Gauntlet coming later this year, you'll have to weigh the risk on that one. But if you roll for Miss Crane, I would very strongly recommend prioritizing Koyanskaya of Light in the coming banners and making sure you get at least one copy of her to get those double synergies for your attacker of choice. And if you have to cut your losses this year, don't despair. Miss Crane returns one more time next year as part of a download campaign summoning banner, so you won't have to rely on the GSSR to get things done. Thanks for watching. I'll be rolling for Tiamat this weekend. Yes, that Tiamat. So stop on by the stream to get in on the action. Twitch.tv/Finotaisen. I stream every weekend, 3 p.m. Pacific time, Friday through Sunday. Also expect to see my Miss Crane role highlights over on Fino and Friends. The video on screen will take you over there. With that said, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. Peace out.